try to give you some of the highlights. Prior to coming to Penn Law, Rangita was the inaugural director of the Wilson Center's Global Women's Leadership Initiative. She's widely published in human rights, public policy, and institutional reform, and most recently is the dean of University of Pennsylvania Law School International Program. Opportunities that are available for students. I think that this symposium here is a marker of the things that Rangita is doing here at Penn Law. And I can personally say that I really have not, I've met few people who are so passionate and devoted to the work that they do, who are so willing to leverage their vast personal network for students. I can speak from personal experience on that. And who are willing to be, I think as our panelists said last time, a champion of women. Because I really think that Rangita leads by example and is not fearful to really bring up young lawyers and help them find their place in international law, whether that be human rights law, whether that be international business, capital markets, what have you. So it's my great pleasure to introduce Rangita de Silva to Alwis, and she will be leading our panel, Women in Power. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Chelsea, for that very beautiful and moving introduction. As trailblazers, we all stand on the shoulders of giants. And trailblazers are obliged to open doors for others. And you, Chelsea, are one of the most inspiring young women at Penn Law. And you were one of the first to knock on my door when I came here in February. And I'm thrilled to see you in South Africa at IFC doing what you've always been passionate about. And thank you for flying in for 2 days to to lead this symposium as the co-editor of the symposium. So thank you, Chelsea. Nancy Gertner has said, "My generation needs to tell their stories." But before I ask Nancy and Indira to tell their stories, I want to take a moment to tell the story of this symposium and the story of two young men who came to my office early in May, telling me that they would like to host a symposium that would advance the global equal justice agenda on behalf of women and advance gender equality globally. So when I was in discussions with them, I said that one way in which Penn Law could strengthen its bridges with global initiatives would be if Penn Law could be at the forefront of redefining national security to include women's security so that the language on national security and the discourse on national security could be reconceptualized to include gender and women's security as a pivotal part of national security. And in that framework, to align Penn Law's own work with what is happening globally in marking the Beijing Plus 20 platform, in marking the recently adopted Sustainable Development Goals, especially goal number 5.1 on ending discrimination and violence against women, and of course 15 years of 1325, which call for women's leadership in peace and security. And then I asked them, Nick Griffin and Ben Johnson, Ben Johnson, who is the managing editor of the Journal of International Law, and Nick Griffin, who is the co-editor with Chelsea of the Symposium, what motivated them, what drove them, and what was behind their vision? Because remember, this is two young Penn law men in my office asking to champion gender equality globally. And they had no idea at that moment that they were making history, either at Penn Law or in the community or around the world, and that they were situating themselves not just as ambassadors, but champions of global gender equality. And then they told me their stories. And I hope, Nick and Ben, you will excuse me if I were to share this story with this community of friends. They told me that they were the sons of single mothers, and that their mothers, coming of age in the 50s and 60s, could not fulfill their full potential because of the impediments and the barriers that these women faced. And they told me, Ben told me that he was going to be a father soon, and that he wanted every opportunity for his wife and for the daughter that he might have. And Nick told me that he was going to be married a week after the symposium, and that he wanted every opportunity for his wife, and that he did not want the barriers and the impediments that his mother experienced to in any way prevent his wife and daughter from fulfilling their full potential. So these were the words that motivated this symposium, both at a personal and political level. So I want to take a moment to celebrate the men and women of the Journal of International Law. The women especially, every time I wrote about this story to Dean Ruger, both Ben and Nick wrote back saying, remember Chelsea, remember the women. Remember the women. We speak on behalf of the women of the Journal of International Law. They come first. So these are extraordinary men of the Journal of International Law. You have joined the women of the Journal of International Law to break barriers for your generation. You're the new spokespersons for your generation. And I celebrate you and I salute you. But then this story ties to another story that was played out in the 50s, the 60s, and the 70s. So when they were telling me this story of discrimination that the women of the 60s and the 70s faced, the impediments that they faced, I thought of two women working in different continents who had spent the full span of their career, 40 odd years, breaking down those barriers, dismantling those impediments, both in law and practice, in the United States and in India. I call Indira Jaising the Ruth Bader Ginsburg of India, and I call Nancy Gertner the Ruth Bader Ginsburg of the United States. Because she did, even before Ruth Bader Ginsburg did this at a national level, she struck down sexual harassment, created a whole new legal framework in Massachusetts by arguing the first sexual harassment case in Massachusetts. Indira, who had no idea of what Nancy was doing, was arguing the first sexual harassment case in India. They have together argued some of the biggest landmark cases in India and the United States. They are preeminent litigators, women's rights litigators, first and foremost, and then they went on to serve their governments at the highest levels of power, walking the corridors of power. Judge Gertner, as a federal judge in Massachusetts, appointed by President Clinton, the husband of a classmate at Yale, Hillary Clinton, Indira Jaising as the first additional Solicitor General of India, first woman additional Solicitor General of India. Before they joined government, Indira was the first woman to practice in the High Courts of Delhi. You were the first, one of the first women trial lawyers in the United States, trailblazers on whose shoulders women now stand on. And I want to take a moment to pay tribute to two friends and mentors who have opened doors, who have inspired me, and so many generations of women for whom you have been a trailblazer and an inspiration. So, in so many different and interesting ways, their lives parallel each other. And unknowing to each other, Nancy Gertner wrote In Defense of Women, and Indira Jaising's chapter on the outsider-insider perspective on being a woman trial lawyer who then entered government is uncannily similar. And I wanted to quote from some of their works. Nancy Gertner has said, Nancy, when she sued Harvard Law School, the very school in which she teaches now, over the tenure of Claire Dalton, who was unfairly, in her words, denied tenure, she says, these women were me. What they had experienced, I knew or could well imagine, up close and personal. They were insiders with outsider consciousness. And Indira, you have said, I am an outsider, inside. And Nancy, you quote Lani Guinea when you say, insider privileges and outsider consciousness. So they have lived their lives as an insider-outsider. So I think what they mean by that is even when they were inside, even when they were walking those corridors of power, they brought that rebel instinct, that revolutionary instinct to bear on all their work. And I think that's what makes them fascinating. And I want you to take a moment to speak about that philosophy. And I will ask you other questions, but I want you to start with that philosophy of being an insider from the outside.
You're looking at me.
Yes.
Okay. So you were an outsider when I was the only woman in the courtroom, literally, when I started. There were no women clerks, there were no women guards, and there were surely and no women judges, and there were surely no women lawyers. And everything about that experience resonated, which is to say, once you opened your mouth, I'm sure many in the room have had the same experience, my high-pitched voice seemed to bounce off the walls. The judge would note that I was the only woman in the room and would have some generally lame and idiotic joke. I had extended discussions about what I should be called. I developed a whole dialogue of sort of ways of making fun of the judge when he was asking me tiresomely whether or not I should be Miss, Mrs. or Ms. To which I would generally respond, you can call me counselor. At that point, you couldn't hear a pin drop in the courtroom. But I had a profound sense of how different I was in every court that I participated in. And you know, the women of my generation also have the experience of applying to law firms and being told women can't be litigators, applying for positions in universities and told that women's research is essentially trivial. The only difference, and this gets to the outsider consciousness, is that I took notes. I take notes on everything. I recounted everyone who'd ever said those things to me. And ladies and gentlemen, when I became a judge, I remembered. I remembered. Now I knew I couldn't, I would note it. I knew that I couldn't do anything about it, but I certainly could put in context what was happening to me. I became a judge through a process which I don't know whether Rangita wants to get into, which was an unusual process. It wasn't, I was an outsider, not just because I was a woman. I had a very unusual background to become a judge. My book begins with a panel discussion between me and Justice, now Justice Sonia Sotomayor, about how does one become a judge. So my outsider consciousness was even more pronounced. She began, you go to this wonderful school, she was talking about Yale, and you do very well. You become, you work for the government, and you go into a law firm. You have opinions and things you care about, but you're cautious as how you express them, and you become a judge. And it was my turn, I said. You go to this fine law school, you do very well, you clerk for a judge, you work in private practice, and then you represent the first lesbian feminist radical revolutionary accused of killing a police officer you can find. That would be your first case on prime time. You then take every abortion case in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, every sexual harassment case. You burn your bar card on the Boston Common because of some horrible Supreme Court decision. And for the final coup de grace, you marry the legal director of the American Civil Liberties Union of Massachusetts, and you become a judge. So it was not just a question of being the only woman in courtrooms, it was also a question of the choices that I had made. I had chosen to represent women like me to some degree, and women not like me, but many, many women. So I sued Harvard Law School based on a tenure. Indeed, I sued the court I joined on behalf of a woman clerk who had been passed over for promotion. Someone once said to me that I shouldn't be introduced in terms of my degrees, but I should be introduced in terms of the universities that I sued. I had no sense that I was going to be a judge one day. I didn't do this cautiously. I didn't calculate. I just did what I loved. And then when I had to don the black robes, I'm writing about this now, it's an interesting question. You put on black robes precisely to cover your difference. And all of a sudden, I was the ultimate insider with outsider consciousness. And how one navigates that as a judge was a challenge. I'm reminded of a comment that Supreme Court Justice Breyer made at a discussion I participated in yesterday. Someone asked him whether his background figured into his judging. And I was surprised at his answer, because usually men don't admit this. He said, yes and no. He said, of course it does not. I'm a judge. I put on the robes. I deal with the law. And then he said, of course it does. And that was an interesting observation, because of course it does. And the question is how? All of us, the question had only been asked of me as a judge, whether, you know, how my gender played into my judging, and I got to the point where I said, do ask the male judges that, because they have gender too. It just happens not to be mine. But how does it play in? How do you navigate positions of power as an outsider, not just as a woman, but also, I didn't come up with wealth. My parents had very modest means. How do you navigate it, representing the people that I represented? How do you forget those experiences? How do they lawfully and reasonably play out in a judicial career? Those were some of the challenges maybe we can talk about.
I can't tell you my life story in 15 minutes, but I would like to first answer your question about the insider-outside, or the outsider-inside. And it's amazing how you've chosen this panel, frankly, because we are separated by continents and by oceans, and yet we seem to have had very similar experiences. We also seem to belong to the same age group, and we also seem to have come of age at very critical moments in the history of our own countries. But may I say something, Rangita? You've titled this panel, Women of Power. I'd like to say a few words about power before I talk about inside, outside. And it is my firm belief that there has been a redefinition of power in the last 15, 20 years, in the sense that I believe that power has actually shifted out of the hands of the state and into the hands of civil society. Now, this is very true for India. Okay, I find that in the last 20 or 30 years, the way things have moved in my country, people like me, call me an outsider, call me part of civil society, call me a citizen, call me what you like. But I find that there are many others like me, and I find that slowly power has shifted into the hands of people like us. And the reason for this, I think, is more and more internationally, states are losing their legitimacy in terms of their moral legitimacy. And suddenly you find that civil society has become the moral conscience keeper of our societies. And I think that is a framework in which I have thrived. I have welcomed, I have thrived, and I have taken every possible opportunity to grab those history-making moments which gave me the opportunity to move forward. So in terms of being an outsider, amazingly, I think I found myself an outsider because I was a woman and also because of the clients I represented. I did represent what in India we call the victims of undeserved want. So these could be people fighting for their minimum wages. They could be people who were just denied, who were discriminated on the basis of sex. They could be people who were discriminated on account of their poverty. They could be just anybody, but they themselves were outsiders. And I, of course, as she said, made my choices and I threw in my lot with them. Now, many people who come and work with me ask me this question, and they say, but Ms. Jaising, how can we do it? We can't, because, you know, we have, you know, this heavy burden, we have loans to repay, and we don't know where all this is going to go. And how do we know that we'll ever become successful and things like that? So I think the answer to that is here in front of you in the shape of both of us. And I do think that I also became an insider primarily because of the cases I've argued, primarily because of the values that I espoused. And perhaps, again, it was a moment in history which compelled our governments to appoint a woman. As she told you, I was the first. It was also a moment in history which compelled our government to recognize what human rights means. Until then, the whole dimension of human rights was missing from governance. And suddenly, there came a moment when they felt, well, but we can't ignore the whole human rights constituency which is out there. And therefore, they felt compelled that they should appoint a person such as me as a Solicitor General to represent the government of India. Now, that again brings in its own challenges, as she said. The point is, what do you do? Am I supposed to metamorphosize and suddenly become the person I'm not? Or am I supposed to now just mouth all the stuff that governments tend to put out? Am I supposed to say, all right, now I'm going to become an instrument of oppression, whereas earlier I was standing in contradistinction to oppression? These were my challenges. Now, I will just leave you, and then I had to kind of redefine the role of the Solicitor General as being not the mouthpiece of the government of India, but the mouthpiece of the people of India. And that really was a big challenge. I can only give you one very small example and leave it at that. On one occasion, a woman from the Ministry of Home Affairs walked into my office, and it was a critical, critical case that I was handling. The issue was payment of compensation to the victims of the Gujarat riots of 2002. And there I was arguing this case on behalf of the government, and the court was demanding to know from me, madam, what compensation have you paid to these victims? And what have you done to give them rehabilitation? What have you done to give them re-employment? So obviously my answer had to come from the Ministry of Home Affairs. And so I'd called this woman into my office. She was a high-ranking officer, close to the position of secretary or whatever. And I said to her, give me my answers. I have to answer the court. She looked at me and she said, what are you here for? You're here to defend me. Don't ask me questions. Just go to the court and explain to them that we've done nothing. So I had to tell her, madam, walk out of my office now. And I'm going to complain against you to the Prime Minister, because please understand clearly and unambiguously that my role is not to defend you. My role is to defend the Constitution of India in my capacity as a Solicitor General of India. So of course she put her tail between her feet and walked out of my office. But these are some of the challenges that I had to face.
So you both, Nancy and Indira, came of age at distinctive historic moments. And you have both said that those moments in history have shaped who you are and the battles that you have fought. Nancy, you came of age during the Vietnam War. That was when you were a law student at Yale. That was your watershed moment. Your coming of age, your reawakening moment, Indira, was the post-emergency moment in 1975 in India, and the burgeoning public interest litigation, the social action litigation that arose as almost like a redemptive effort to roll back some of the ill effects of the emergency. So I want you to speak a little bit about those moments in history, but also I want you to pause and reflect whether there might be yet another moment about to dawn now. As we said, there are these momentous international global movements afloat, but we are also at a point, at least in this country, where a woman is running again for president and is seen as her party's front runner. So do you think that this is again one of those profoundly important moments that might propel you and other women and other men, and that this might be a call to action?
It's a little hard for me to be objective on that point, since this particular woman is a friend of mine. But it's interesting. I mean, I don't know whether it would be a call to action. On the one hand, it is remarkable that she is there and is a front runner. On the other hand, it is extraordinary that it has taken this amount of time. It's just extraordinary when other countries of the world, this is an ordinary occurrence. It's extraordinary for us. It's extraordinary given our leadership in the women's rights movement from 40 years ago that we should be coming to this point now. The answer is I don't know. On the one hand, it's quite amazing that this is happening. On the other hand, I'm worried about the attacks on her. I'm worried about the sexism that will be reflected in the discussion. I just have to say, and I know this isn't partisan, but she's so, by dimensions, qualified for the job. By dimensions. And the notion that there could be a debate about anything else in this country, that's what I'm saying. To some degree, it communicates the wrong thing. By dimensions, I'm reminded of a very silly thing that occurred when I was just a beginning in my judicial career, and there was an opening in one of the departments that the judges supervise. And the most likely candidate was a senior woman who was absolutely fabulous. And she had watched in her career men be constantly promoted over her. And we as the court had to pick who was going to be the next chief. And really, that there should have been no issue. But of course, what happened was that at the last minute, someone who was sponsored by a local politician came in. And there was literally a robust discussion from judges and judges of my generation about what to do about this other person's candidacy. And it was really not a competition at all. But one began to see in that room how it was that this woman was overlooked over and over again. Because the roots to power that he had, her competitor, she didn't have. She didn't have the patronage of a local politician. She only had her competence. Now, you know, Hillary's in a different kind of situation, but the notion that there is a debate that we talk about her hair or we talk about, you know, her age. So I don't know what the message is going to be. I mean, I'm concerned a little bit about the message. I came of age, it was not just the Vietnam War. I mean, we were classically the generation that was wonderfully buffeted by social movements. I had planned to, you know, become an academic, and I never could sit still in the library. I was demonstrating about something or other. It was the anti-war movement, it was then the civil rights movement, and then it was the women's movement. And what was wonderful about this time is that it was a thrill to be able to use my skills at the service of these movements. When people talk about the women's movement and about feminists and it being sort of, you know, boring and humorless, it was euphoric. It was euphoric to align fancy Yale Law School and Penn skills at the service of people who needed them. And I felt privileged every moment to be a part of that. I have to admit that when I left the bench, I also thought I was going to repair to the libraries at Harvard Law School and I would teach and write. And I can't stop demonstrating. So it's a lifelong struggle. I love the academic life, but I cannot sit still and only be that. But it really, we're privileged to be able to be in this room and to align our lives and our work lives with our values, rather than spend your 9-to-5 day doing X, and then on the evenings and weekends doing Y. It really is a privilege that I just could not resist and still can't resist.
Yeah. So Rangita, I need to thank you for asking me this question because it really stimulated thought. And yes, I had a coming of age moment. And that was in 1975 when the late Mrs. Indira Gandhi declared an emergency in the country. And no matter which side of the political spectrum we were on, I knew very clearly that this was an attack on our rights. And I too threw my lot. Funnily again, that's another thing we have in common. I've always wondered why I never became an academic, but I think the answer is very similar. I can't sit still. And so I just have to be, and I was telling Rangita that my happiest moments have been when I've been inside the Supreme Court of India, challenging either that most famous male lawyer or maybe the most male chauvinist judge. But to come back to these moments in history, it was a defining moment for many, many people of my generation. And we knew on that day which side of history we were on. And we've never regretted it. We fought against the emergency, we faced arrest, we faced raids in our office, but we continued to represent the railway workers who were on strike. And that was another moment of coming of age in my life, that I did represent large sections of the working class throughout my career. And I do it to this day. So yes, it has been defining. And then of course, the Vietnam, anti-Vietnam demonstrations traveled all the way to India. And I remember in India too, we were demonstrating in solidarity and things like that. So it is a moment in history. But I would like to come back to the context in which this conference is taking place. That is the issue of security. I find that in India, the meaning of the word security is being now contested by civil society. And far from empowering state players, once again, we are in the process of empowering non-state actors. And we are interested in knowing how we can use these international commitments to further our national aims. Now, the moment in history that we have now is that we have a democratically elected prime minister in our country. And the party which brings him to power and the government which is in place says that they can legitimately do whatever they want to do, including trampling on the rights of minorities in a very big way. I was having a discussion with Farah, and we were suddenly discussing the similarities. A Pakistani journalist actually made a statement, and they said, we thought India was the world's biggest democracy, but now we've suddenly realized that the Indians are no different from the Pakistanis in the way in which they treat their minorities. And so, to come back to your question, we are at another moment in history where I could be completely wrong, and the next speaker from India that you have at conferences like this might give you a completely different perspective. You know, our Prime Minister is feted and felicitated in this country. He's now known in India as a the Indian word for it is Yuga Purush. That means a male world leader. A male world leader. It's not just a world leader, but that's how he's described. And that's how he's celebrated in this country, which we resent, let me tell you. Because it is this country who failed to give him a visa for 7 long years for the role that he played in the Gujarat riots. And yet today, he's welcomed with open arms. So that brings us back, bang, into the whole question of, do we prioritize women's empowerment over militarization? What are we talking about over here? And unless we get those priorities right, we are hardly going to get anywhere. I personally feel that in India, we are at a moment in history where we are once again challenged, once again being called upon to redefine what we mean by democracy. And what we mean, the most important debates in India right now are how do you define the idea of India, quote unquote, the idea of India. So, going back to the Nehruvian era, going back to the time when I was born, I call myself one of midnight's children because we were born around the time of independence. And we grew up with a very different idea of what India was all about. It was so totally inclusive. We didn't think which community we belonged to, which religion we belonged to. We were just there. And we inherited this all the ideas of the freedom movement. And somewhere down the line, I am very clear, and there are many like me in India, I'm not alone, who think that this idea of India is very much threatened. And so to answer your question, yes, we are at a moment in history where we have to reclaim the ideas of our independence movement, and I see my work located over there.
Thank you. So you both have many firsts in your name. Both of you in different jurisdictions have dismantled gender discrimination in the law. You, as I said earlier, have argued some of the first sexual harassment cases as well as the first gender discrimination cases. But I think what is most remarkable about this experience for the two of you has been the ways in which you have aligned yourself with the lives of the women on whose behalf you have argued, the women whom you have represented. And I want to take a moment to ask the audience, how many of you have read God of Small Things, Arundhati Roy's God of Small Things? Good. So how many of you know about Arundhati Roy's Pickle Factory, the pickle factory in the book? It's not a figment of her imagination. It is real. The pickle factory existed in Kerala in India. But the pickle factory could only be handed down to a son under the Kerala Christian law. And when Arundhati Roy writes about the pickle factory, she's reminiscing about her mother, Mary Roy, who could not inherit equally with her brothers. And Indira's client was Mary Roy. She argued on behalf of Mary Roy, and she dismantled those discriminatory practices in the Christian personal laws. Then she represented a Muslim woman who faced similar discrimination under the Muslim personal laws. And then she represented some of India's two most prominent women. One is Vandana Shiva and Geeta Hariharan. I mean, these are legendary names because they are some of the major environmentalists, major economists who could not open a bank account in their names because they were not considered to be the legal guardians of their sons while their husbands were alive. Indira represented them. So what Nancy says is these were my battles. These were not Geeta's battle or Arundhati Roy's. These were their battles that they embraced, and they aligned themselves with the lives of their clients. You and Susan Sachs. And these women chose these lawyers because of their ideological positions, because they were feminist lawyers. So will you speak a little bit about that, the connections to both the law that you were fighting for to be changed, but also the women that you were representing?
To some degree, it began for the wrong reasons, right? Men wouldn't hire me. I did civil rights work and I did criminal law, and to some degree it was the beginning of women looking for women lawyers precisely because they didn't trust their representation to a man. So that was, and as I said, it was at least a, was almost a market issue initially. This one story that I tell in my book, which is actually not a big case, but it sort of reflects this, is a woman who claimed that her psychiatrist was having sex with her. And it was her word against a very high profile, credentialed psychiatrist. And no one in town would take the case because they didn't believe her. And I did. And I was right, and we ultimately proved that these events had happened. But so part of it was women were choosing women. Part of it was what I said a moment ago, which is when you align your passion and your work, you are unstoppable. I'm persuaded that I don't do as well when I am working for something that I don't believe in. My skills are such that I can generally manage. But it's a very different relationship when you're aligning your passion and your work. And ultimately, in my case, that meant representing professional women, because their struggles were very much my struggles, but also poorer families, because in fact that is where I had come from. And then when I got on the bench, when I first wrote this book, the last chapter is. Was very defensive in the first time. It was, you're a what? How did you become a judge from being this civil rights person? It was very defensive. By the time I finished my career, it's no longer defensive. I now know what I brought to the table that other judges didn't bring. They may have brought other things, but there was a critical view that I had that I approached the law with, that because I remembered the laws being manipulated against women, I understood the implications of inheritance laws, etc. And just as a final reflection of that, one of the last cases I had as a judge was the case of a woman who claimed that she was a woman prisoner, and she claimed that a guard had had sex with her. And the sex had lasted over a period of almost a year and a half. When she got out, she sued the guard. The guard actually was criminally prosecuted. It is almost a strict liability offense. It was clearly wrong. But she also sued the supervisors and the administration. This had been a man's prison that became a woman's prison. The guards remained the same. The security remained the same. Nobody was trained. My law clerk, this was literally my last year of judging. My law clerk came to me and said, you have to dismiss this case. It's just a complaint alleging this. She said, you have to dismiss this case. And what do you mean I have to dismiss this case? Well, there are 20 decisions that say that the Eighth Amendment, the constitutional claim of cruel and unusual punishment, doesn't apply to this because there was no force involved. Because in the constitutional claims in prisons are reserved for, very serious kinds of incursions, and this doesn't meet that. 20 cases, she said. Well, I'm a district court judge at the time, and the 20 cases were other district court cases, and I actually didn't have to follow them. They were not precedential on my level. But I said to her, this doesn't make sense. And that clearly came from who I had been. Another judge, perhaps, one, there are many good ones, but another judge might well have said, whoopee, I can dismiss this case, and I'll cite 20 cases, a string cite, right? A through, 1 through 20, it'll be over, and then I'll move on to the next case. I said, it makes no sense. Come back with a description of what the facts were in these cases. Tell me what the rationale was. Don't give me the quote dismissing these cases, because it doesn't make sense to me. Now, that wasn't saying the woman will win. That was saying I was going to dig. I was going to dig further into this. And it seemed to me that was entirely appropriate. Well, it turned out those 20 cases were, interestingly enough, all cases in which male prisoners were suing female guards. And while the judges were not saying it, clearly the implication was no big deal. These guys were having a wonderful time. There was no meaningful analysis. And I decided I was going to write about how in prison coercion means something other than beating you over the head. That these are not meaningful choices, and that the Eighth Amendment at least should apply, and this woman should be entitled to a jury trial, and she had one. But it was approaching, I understood what my role was. I was not there to make her win. But I was certainly going to be critical about the law that was being cited to me from the perspective that I had both as a woman and as a civil rights lawyer. So these were the little cases, it seemed to me, that I was going to reflect this. And now, actually, after I left the bench, my decision, all the other judges that have cases like this have to deal with this decision, which is just fabulous. And now I'm in a great position, because if they deal with it and I don't like it, I can write about it.
Okay. So to just come back to your question about, again, so many similarities, I'll tell you later.
We've bonded for life. I just made a note, I'm going to come visit you.
And Rangita has been trying to get us together for the last 10 years.
It took a decade.
Anyway, so, yeah, so to come back to your question about Mary Roy and where I come into the picture, again, it was a moment in history which was after the emergency of 1975. And as I've said in that little memoir, which for some reason Rangita likes a lot, it says, I ask myself the question, is it an accident that the very judges who wrote the emergency judgment where they said the right to life doesn't exist in an emergency are also the judges who gave birth to a new jurisprudence of public interest litigation? It was the same Justice Bhagwati who wrote the judgment saying that the right to life is suspended in an emergency. Mrs. Gandhi gets defeated in a general election, a new government comes to power, and we have the same Supreme Court now telling us that there is something known as cause lawyering and public interest litigation, and we are there to bring cases to court. So Mary Roy's case was brought in that period. We suddenly found that the Supreme Court became a far, far more democratic space than it had ever been in the past. And they allowed anybody to come to court. And they would even entertain letters. If I'm not mistaken, Mary Roy did start her journey by just writing a letter to the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court and saying that, what is the meaning of this unequal law where a woman inherits nothing and the son gets everything? She challenged it, and she just happened to find me because I came of age in that period, in that courtroom. I was just there, the right person at the right time, but certainly it was a question of recognizing that time and that opportunity.
Yes.
And just grabbing it. So this is what happened, and that's how I dealt with cases like this. And the case did ultimately result in a judgment which said that there will be only one law for Christian women, and that law will be a law which gives inheritance equally to men and women. Of course, Mary Roy knew that her battle didn't end over there, because there was also the right to make a will, and What happened after that, it might interest you to know, Teresa sitting there was asking me that question. What was the impact of that judgment? Well, it was the Syrian Christian community, which is very, very strongly organized within their churches. And Mary was telling me that there were priests from their pulpits advising their flock to make wills, disinheriting the daughter. And so these were the kind of battles that she had to fight, you know, and the other battle that she had to fight was a battle against her own brother who stood to lose a lot of property if she got her fair share of the property. And she just, that battle just went on and on and on. But the great thing is that we remained friends for life. I have actually remained friends for life with the women that I've represented. And I've noticed that they have kept up their revolutionary spirit. For them, the case was not the beginning and end of their life. It can't be. No case can be the beginning and end of any person's life. Every person who goes to court has a pre-court life and an after-court life. And I've been fortunate enough to be part of that life that they've lived, these women have lived. So I would just like to say that they transformed me and I did transform them. So it's been a symbiotic relationship.
So I know that the audience is dying to pick your brains, so I'm going to open up this panel to the audience. But before that, I want to take a moment again to go back to the story of Nick and Ben. So why I thought this conversation would align so well and perfectly fit the story that they told me was because the two of you have spent now cumulatively 80 years breaking down barriers.
You had to say that. Okay.
Breaking down barriers, but in your words, bringing down the signs that said men only. And that's what I think Nick and Ben referred to when they said their mothers were not able to fulfill their full potential. They could not have the same opportunities as men during their time because of those male-only signs. Male-only can apply for these jobs. Male-only can apply for these clubs. Male-only membership. So you grew up in that male-only membership club. But by breaking down those signs, by dismantling those barriers, you have really, I think, vindicated Bradwell. Many of the women law students here and the women lawyers will remember Bradwell versus Illinois as the first women and law case that you probably have been exposed to, where the judge said famously, a woman's paramount destiny is to fulfill the noble office of wife and mother, and denied her bar application in Illinois. So we've come a long way because of women like you battling for those rights here in the US, and because of you, India, because as you said, you know, Indira has famously said, ideas travel. And there's cross-border wings to ideas. And I think, you know, these ideas keep traveling and germinating and growing and you know, now coming to Penn Law. So before I open up the audience for questions, I want to thank the two of you for, as you said, you know, you cannot remain quiet. Mm. You cannot remain still. Harvard Law has managed to corral you, and we have managed to corral Indira for 3 weeks. When I first invited her to visit Penn Law as a visiting global professor, she said, Rangita, I'm happiest in a court of law. Don't limit me to an academic environment. But we managed to bring you here, and we're thankful to have you here. And so now questions.
Centuries-old constitution, so women's movements have what we struggle for here is formal equality, like, you know, taking down those signs that say women only, but now that we have that, we still know that there, in our halls of power, there's no equality, no structural barriers, so we have different sort of, but it's hard to motivate women at this stage because they seem to think that everything is equal because in obvious space it is. So how do we address those challenges? And so the question for India, obviously, is that, you know, the Indian constitution was a post, you know, UN convention framework, human rights constitution. Mm-hmm. It's built with beautiful equality language for all communities, all castes, and, you know, affirmative action is built, you know, into the constitution. It's not allowed, it's acceptable, it's, you know, there's quota bills for women. So, but what, so what, there are different challenges there. So how do you see the next, you know, generation of challenges being addressed in India as well for women?
For the women here, and particularly the young women I teach, you have to collect stories and be a statistician. So when a woman gets turned down for a job, or I've heard, or women would call me up who I taught, or get sexually harassed in a law firm, and they will think it is an individual problem, and it could well be an individual problem, but I say it's more likely an atmospheric social culture problem. And the notion is to figure out how to share your stories, have some understanding of how much this is happening, because it's through doing that that you'll see the institutional connections. Women will say to me, I'm working in a law firm, I think I'm gonna go into, one woman said to me, I'm gonna go into trusts and estates, I'll deal with dead people's law because I wanna be able to combine that with a family. So I said to her, oh, are you committed to someone? She said, no. Do you have any children? No. Are you engaged? No. Is there a significant other? No. I said, well, then why are you shaping your career now for the discrimination that you anticipate? Because if you do that, when the discrimination comes, you know, first you're abandoning the field to other women, and you're basically making a personal, believing that your choice is a personal one to navigate around these institutional structures. It is not a personal choice. It is not a personal choice. It is a choice essentially not to take on the fight. And the fight has to move then to the institutional supports for discrimination. It has to move to, I keep on coming back to this, no one is mentioning Bernie Sanders' age, but they mention Hillary Clinton's age. We have to move to changing the discourse and sort of noting those kinds of issues. It's not, the scene has shifted so that the signs are down, but the patterns still remain. But really, frankly, I mean, it goes back to my point about not being able to sit still. You have to mobilize. I mean, if there's a demonstration right now in town, you should let me know, because I'd love to go to it. but I mean, that's a sort of funny way of putting it, but it really is, you have to put your stories together. You have to recognize that what you're facing is not something you're facing individually. It is something, I mean, I have a really ridiculous parallel here, just a ridiculous parallel, which I just, this is the way I think. Every woman in this room, except the older women, I think, and I want to put you in that category, is wearing a black suit, right? I went on a website with my law clerks once, and they said that they're told, women are told that you have to wear a black suit and a black skirt and no pants when you interview at law firms, and no pantsuit, rather, when you interview at law firms and in court. Now, men have a costume that they have to wear, too. There's no question about it. But the difference between the woman's costume and that is much more dramatic for a woman than it is for a man. So I have actually just gone back into court, and as Rangita knows, I love to wear red. And I am having a wonderful time wearing variations of fire engine red in every court I enter. It's a silly story, but it reflects something about the notion of whether you have to fit yourself into the hole that is created for you rather than recreate the hole, recreate the structures. So I want everyone to take off their black jackets now. But really, when you look around, there's only the older women who are wearing, you know, stuff like that, have a red shirt on.
Okay. Again, I have to say that the answer is quite similar, though our two constitutions are very different, the American Constitution and the Indian Constitution. And as you rightly point out, the Indian Constitution is what I always describe as a post-Second World War Constitution. So it inherits the whole United Nations Charter. It's written into the Constitution. Secondly, of course, we have this huge, huge affirmative action, which we call, it goes beyond affirmative action, we call it reservation for scheduled caste, scheduled tribes, women, et cetera, et cetera. So you would imagine that we live in a land of paradise, but we don't. And so to come to the to your question that how does one move above this and how does one visualize the future? Again, the only way to visualize the future is to think of institutional change. Okay, and for me, the biggest challenge has been how to dismantle patriarchal attitudes that I observe towards other women and myself.
You mentioned the color of the suit. You forgot the word conservative. Oh, yeah. I mean, the suit has to be conservative. Yes. It just can't be only black, you know. Yes. Bringing the sign of only men down is fine. But what do you do when you live in a country when the sign goes up with the next government immediately where women or men plaintiffs and their lawyers are arrested together? Because one, to bring up the, you know, complaint, the second one, for defending that remedy. Thirdly, when your own constitution is not respected, how do you deal with that? And this is the question that a lot of young women lawyers and even male lawyers in a country like Iran are, you know, dealing with. You know, they don't know. The number of women lawyers sitting in jail in Iran is extraordinary.
Okay, just a few comments. I think you're making a very important point about the Constitution not being respected. And I did hear you say in your closing comments that never forget the importance of the rule of law and never stop fighting for the defense of the rule of law. And that's where I'm linking, you know, with your comment. So, we are finding ourselves in a situation in India right now. We call ourselves the world's largest democracy. And suddenly we find ourselves in a situation, and our constitution, by and large, has always been respected. But in the last 1.5 years, we suddenly find ourselves operating in a framework within which the Constitution is not being respected. And obviously, we are being challenged, and we are being called upon to devise strategies. How do we deal with this? And I can only tell you that we are still finding our way. We are still struggling. But recently, I give you an example of what's been happening in India very recently. We've suddenly found that a lot of intellectuals, a lot of authors, a lot of writers, a lot of filmmakers, a lot of artists have found a way of articulating their discontent. And what they've been doing is, you know, they've been recipients of state awards and things like that. They've been returning these awards, you know, back to the state, and they've been making their reasons very clear. That we are doing it because the idea of India is under attack. And this is not the India that gave us these awards. This is an India which is very far from our imagination. And so I would say they have found a way of protesting. So therefore, I guess each professional constituency then has to find its own way of protesting against this collapse of... We also have to work at the international level. And our Prime Minister was actually invited to this city, to Wharton, and the students organized and said, we're not going to have him here. He was chucked out of this city. And because he was told, you have not accounted for the 2,000 deaths of Muslims which occurred in the year 2002, unless you account for that, we will not allow you to come and address this country. So that is why I was saying we are alarmed to see a reversal of this trajectory, and to see that now he's considered the global leader. So I can only tell you it's a very, I mean, you know better than me, I don't have to tell you, having been to prison and whatnot. So yes, we are currently in danger of being thrown into prison, human rights defenders in India. I personally faced that threat of facing imprisonment. But when it comes in very devious ways. It doesn't come directly like it came in your country, you know. In our country, it's coming through in very indirect ways. And one of the ways is, well, you took foreign funding. And this foreign funding came from the CIA. And you know, they have a global agenda of destabilizing third world countries. And now you're part of that. You're an agent of a global network. And they did this to one of the women I represented, who was working with Greenpeace, and she wanted to go to the UK to make a presentation to the MPs about the dangers of mining and what it did to tribal peoples and how it disenfranchised them, and she was stopped from going. She was told that you can't go because you're going to destabilize the economic interests of the country. So I said, Rangita, you have this conference on women and security, but let me tell you that in today's context in India, the idea of security is being contested. It's being contested on both sides. We are contesting it and saying for us security, as one of the earlier speakers said, women's security is national security. We are contesting it from that point of view. But the government is also contesting the idea of security, and they no longer see security as militarization. They see a threat to security from people like us. We don't have arms. We don't even have the right to carry arms in our country, but they see a threat to security from us, and they're saying that you are threatening the economic security of India by protesting mining leases, by representing the tribals, and by saying no to nuclear energy, by saying don't enter into this contract. You are, so your security, you know, is no longer a given. The meaning of the word security is no longer a given. It's contested.
Questions? Questions from the back?
My turn?
I think there
were
some hands that
were... Rangita?
Yeah.
My turn?
Okay.
Yeah, I have one comment about the clothing. Today I noticed that many women are wearing green, which means hope for peace. And I have two questions. You mentioned the case of a woman who did not get promoted because the man had the piston, what we call the push. Supposing she had that same push, you think she would have gotten promoted? That's my first question. The second one is, you took cases of rape. In our part of the world, in the Muslim Sharia, you can't prove rape. You have to have witnesses. Four witnesses. How do you deal with that? I mean, just the counterfactual, let's put it that way, but it is very difficult in our part of the world to defend a case of rape on that ground. Thank you.
On your first point actually resonates with something from the panel this morning. When you talk about the case of the woman who was promoted, who was obviously more qualified, and there was a man who obviously had insider connections. If she had had those insider connections, would she have gotten the job? And in the United States now, the answer is yes. The answer is yes. Now, that's not necessarily a good thing. It's good for gender. It's not necessarily so good for good government. But it raises something that happened in this morning's panel, which I thought was so interesting. And I think it was actually you who raised it, that there are class... Gender is no longer a simple category. It was never a simple category. It is no longer a simple category in our country. So that just having women in positions of power who have had a life of privilege and have never gone through what we have gone through, is a good thing in the sense it's wonderful in terms of a symbol, but in terms of meaningful change, it is not a good thing. And so Rang and I have always had a conversation about the importance of gender parity. And gender parity is terribly important, but if the occupants of those gender roles are really people who have been privileged, the kinds of concerns we're raising will not be raised here. So yes, she would make it. There are now many more women in politics who are getting there, you know, the old-fashioned way, which is who they knew. And I'm not sure that's better than before, but it doesn't mean that these issues are being addressed. On the issue of rape, I there are moments in international conventions and at conferences when I feel like I have to simply step back and say, you tell me what you need, and we'll help in any way, because I can't even begin to navigate. I can't begin to give you a sense of what one does, except that, and you already know this, you never forget that it's wrong. In other words, the worst thing is to let these kinds of practices become normalized. And so you never forget it's wrong, and you reach out. These discussions are taking place certainly in a much more robust international community for the past 20 years than had ever been before. It's not like you're just reaching out to individual NGOs to help you. It's really a much more robust network, and the internet has made that so. And so the answer is that it's outrageous, and let us know if we can help, or if our participation, American participation, in fact, is the worst imaginable thing that you could have. I think it's a complicated answer, and I don't want to pretend to answer it.
So, there's the buzz to show the difference.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
Other questions?
So, my question is for Mrs. Jaising. You spoke about how the idea of India that existed during independence is under attack. And being someone who identifies himself on the extreme left of left, I would definitely agree with that. Now, I'm wondering, where would the battle for women's rights intersect with the battle to reclaim India, the idea of India that existed during independence?
I'm sorry, your question is, where was the...
Where do you see the intersection between the women's rights movement and the movement to reclaim India as the
okay.
idea of India?
Okay, see, a good question, but I think in India, the women's rights movement has been integrally linked with the other movements for the right to livelihood, for the right to secure environment, for the right to food, for the right to information, for the right to education, and things like that. And that is a running trajectory from before independence, during independence, until today. So our challenge, of course, has been within those many movements. The women's movement is also, part of those movements. And I can see that many of the leaders of some of these movements, the right to food, as you know, it's people like Aruna Roy, the right to information, again, people like her, environment, as she mentioned, Vandana Shiva, etc., who have brought all these concerns to the table. So I think there is a kind of a marriage between these movements when it comes to the issue of women's rights. The specificity of the women's movement in India has been the whole debate over the issue of sexual violence. That is where yes, there is a departure of various movements, and the other movements have not paid attention to these issues. And on that question, many of us in the country have been very active over the years. And of course, there's been global attention now on the issue of rape in India after the Nirbhaya experience. And the fallout of that has also been a very serious questioning of the state on the issue of security for women. And many of the battles now are located in that framework from the women's movement.
So I get to ask the last question from my two panelists. What's next for you in terms of pushing the next frontier in law, in practice, and personal and political? Indira, I know that you came to Penn Law just after having argued one of the most important cases that challenges and erodes democracy in India. The 74th and 75th Amendment in 1994 called for 1/3 representation of women at the village council, the Panchayat Raj level. And that really revolutionized democracy as we knew. In South Asia, it brought 1 million women to the table at the local government village council level. But now, so many years after that revolutionary step, those gains are being rolled back by a call for a qualification for franchise, qualification for running for government. Democracy is being peddled for a bathroom and education. So those who are running for panchayat government office are required to have a bathroom with running water, functioning bathroom, and an 8th grade or 10th grade education. And Indira went before the high courts to argue against this erosion of democracy. So I know that that's your next frontier, and I'm going to ask you to speak more to that. I'm going to start with you, Nancy. What is your next frontier?
I don't know where to begin. I am teaching students, and I'm writing a book on judging. My focus, my immediate focus, actually is not on women's rights issues, although that it is related. My immediate focus is on criminal punishment in the United States, which has become absurd. I just wrote an op-ed which, if anything will wreck my chances for the Supreme Court, this op-ed will. I wrote an opinion piece that begins, I was a judge for 17 years. I sentenced hundreds of men, and they were mostly men, to sentences 80% of which I believed to be disproportionate, unfair, and unjust. And I went on from there. So my immediate plan is to go through the lists of the people that I sentenced over 17 years to try to identify what they should have gotten had there been a humane criminal justice system. So that's an immediate project. It's going to take a little bit of time, but I'm open for any other suggestions.
Okay, Rangita, I thought I'd already answered the question, but because I think in India our priorities are cut out for us. So, I mean, we it's a matter of survival. You can't help but be a political animal in India, in today's India. So you have to come up with a self-image which combines your political instincts with your legal skills. But on the democracy question, yes, it was a very important case. Again, I think a case which challenges the very meaning of democracy. I was looking at a lot of the debates in America, and you'll be interested to know that the judge, presiding judge himself, wanted to know whether there were laws in this country which had to be reversed to enable people of color to vote. Yes, so he even went and did his own research, because you know we were so busy just researching our own jurisprudence on affirmative action for women and on the impact of the fact that the women were being told that unless you have a form, you know, that you have to understand this case arises in the context of illiteracy in the country. So like something like 40% of all women in the country are not literate. So how do you expect them to have a formal education? And to say that you need a formal education as a condition for running for office, that is what we challenged. And so it was so funny, really, because you know it meant going back to absolute basics. And I felt like a fool standing there and telling the judge, well, what is the meaning of government for the people, by the people, of the people? Let's try and understand that. And if you're going to say that 50% of the people can't run for office, can you call it a government for the people, by the people, of the people? So it is, you know, as rudimentary as that, but sometimes governments kind of lose their way and they do enact legislation of this kind. So our government is keeping us very busy, Rangita.
So thank you, but last year, Ben Johnson, the editor-in-chief of the Journal of International Law, lost his mother. So this panel is in tribute to his mother. So thank you, Ben, for for your vision to both honor your mother, but to honor the next generation of women in your class and at the Journal of International Law. Thank you.
Thank you.